Of the show for today. We're talking to Dr. Al-Hadid, formerly from Tennessee State University, and a well-known scholar and author throughout not only the state of Tennessee, but throughout the nation. And of course, Dr. Al-Hadid, let's continue our discussion of the evolution of the Africana Studies Department at Tennessee State University, but also covering some of the other institutions, because Tennessee State University is not the only institution that falls within the context of some of the information that you're giving us. So let's pick it up from that perspective.
Yes, when we established the department at Tennessee State, a couple of things we considered. We wanted it, first of all, to be unique. We wanted it to be academically sound. And we wanted to make sure that we could recruit students to major in it. And one of the big hurdles that we had to deal with, a lot of students were told by various people at the university and sometimes their parents, you know, when they said, well, you don't want to major in Africana Studies, then the question becomes, well, what can you do with a major in Africana Studies, you know? Meaning, what kind of job can you get, you know, with a major in Africana Studies? So that was one of the, that was the fear factor that we had to deal with on the front end. And once the students became comfortable with the kind of knowledge that they were gaining and the fact that they could receive gainful employment, because as I look around, I'm now starting to do a survey of our alumni, I don't know of a single alumni of the Africana Studies Department that does not have a job. I don't know of a single.
That's a great statement that you
yes,
can make.
Yes, I don't know of a single one that does not have a job. Either they work for someone else or they have their own business. I don't know of a single graduate of the Africana Studies Department at Tennessee State University that has not gone on for further training, either to graduate school. A number of them have master's degrees, and we have one young man who almost has his doctor's degree, you know, in Africana Studies. And he, prior to that, he had a master's degree from the University of Michigan in public policy. In fact, we have two that are fairly close to getting their doctor's degrees, and they are very well placed. So my point here is that when you ask the question, what can you do with a major in Africana Studies, I said, well, you can do anything that you want to do. Whatever you can do with a major in sociology, and I'm using sociology because I have my doctor's degree in sociology, you can do with Africana Studies. Whatever you can do with a major in psychology, you can
do history, or
political science, any of the social sciences, any of the behavioral sciences, or any of the humanities, you can do the same thing with a degree in Africana Studies. But one thing that would be different with a major in Africana Studies is that your worldview would be defined by your culture rather than your worldview being defined by someone else's culture. Right? And so that was one of the reasons that many of our colleagues in the traditional departments had to introduce Afro-American history, because American history didn't tell the whole story. You know, that's one of the reasons they had to introduce politics of the black community, because political science 101 didn't tell the whole story, right? So in other words, in a lot of the traditional departments, in the behavior sciences, social sciences, and the humanities, had to correct themselves and critique themselves, because a lot of their disciplines were driven by Europe-centered paradigms, Europe-centered philosophies. I mean, Europe-centered philosophies that go all the way back to the Renaissance, in the case of art, Europe-centered paradigms that go all the way back to Charles Darwin and Origin of Species in the case of sociology. And in all of them, you know, when they start talking about their canon or their classical foundation, you know, if you would ask, who's the father of history, you're going to say Herodotus, you know, rather than W.E.B. Du Bois or somebody, you know what I mean? And so who's the father of political science? Well, Aristotle, you know. So in all these disciplines, they tend to anchor their classical foundation in some Greek philosopher. And then they come all the way down to the Renaissance and then the Reformation, and then they find somebody else to talk, or the Enlightenment, and they find someone else to say that this is the person who is responsible for developing the body of theories or the paradigms and the discipline. And see, giants like W.E.B. Du Bois came along to explode those myths. I mean, he started challenging the University of Chicago in terms of sociology. And so now, over time, due to the pioneering work of Du Bois and E. Franklin Frazier and and John Hope Franklin.